In this module, so you are studying the response of the feedback control systems. Okay, so in the previous modules, it was just only the representation of the various control systems, feedback control systems, using block diagram in the signal flow graph and obtaining the overall transfer function of a system which is represented either in block diagram form or signal flow graph. Okay, so we have used block reduction formula in case the system is represented by block diagrams, or Masson-Seguin formula if a system is given in form of signal flow graphs. Okay, so that particular topic gives how to find out the overall gain of the system, that's all. Okay, now this module is entirely different, where you are analyzing the response of the feedback control system for an applied excitation or the input. Okay, so here the terminology is the input is referred to as excitation and the output is referred to as the response. Okay, so therefore whenever feedback control system is excited, okay, so with the application of a standard test input, so then what is its response? Okay, so what are the various parts in a particular response? So the analysis of this is time, is known as time response of feedback control system. So a more formal definition is here. What exactly is the meaning of time response of feedback control system? So you can see here, this is the response given by the system, which is a function of time, to the applied excitation, is defined as time response of a control system. Okay, so what is time response? It is a response given by the system, which is a function of time, to what? To the applied excitation, and is called as, or it is defined as time response of a control system. So therefore here, the complete evaluation of the system is now based on analysis of such response. So assume that you have applied some known input. For that, the system has generated its response. So therefore, by looking at the response or by analyzing the response scientifically, okay, so you will come to know what is the nature or behavior of the system. Okay, so the study of the entire response or the evaluation of response of such a closed loop control system is called time response analysis of feedback control system. Now, when the system is excited, and finally you are evaluating or getting the response from the system. Okay, so that response is classified into mainly two parts. Okay, so the first part of the response is known as transient response, and the second part is known as steady state response. So that is the response of the system. Okay, it is categorized into two parts. Okay, so one is transient behavior, other one is steady state behavior. Or in other words, the first part of the system, transient response of the system, and the second part can be called as steady state response of the system, and the final state achieved by the output is known as steady state. Why? The variations in the response. Okay, so within the response, so they are known as transients or the transient response. Okay, so whatever the final state of our response is there, that is called steady state. Okay, but before achieving the steady state, so whatever the variations we observe in the response, okay, so they are known as transient behavior or the transient response. So always transients are obtained before our response reaches a steady state. So therefore, as a summary, I can say that the time response analysis is totally dedicated to the analysis of response of a system. So why that analysis is required? Because the analysis of the response reveals some of the characteristics of the system. So such a response is categorized or further. Hello. Yes. Did you listen to the last lecture or not? It was disconnected.
Yes. There is some disturbance.
Okay. Now is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So therefore, according to the definition, now, Allah, did you listen to this definition and all this part?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I think last 1 minute it was disconnected. So therefore, I was taking the summary of this basic introductory part, that is the evaluation of the system. Okay, the evaluation of response of the closed loop system, it reveals some of the features or the characteristics about the system. So that response, okay, it is further classified into two parts, or you can say that the response has two parts. So the first part is the transient response and the second part is the steady state response. So what is it? Transient response. So it is the one, okay, which is available from the system before reaching the steady state. So you can imagine that steady state response is the final response of the system, and transients are the ones which are available before the system attains the steady state response. So this is about some introduction regarding the time response analysis. So now let us see, so what are exactly the meanings of transient response and steady state response, and what are their notations? Yes, hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Ah, yes. I'm going to next page.
Yes, ma'am.
So here, okay. I'm opening the next page. See here. Okay. So here again, I have listed some of the points. That is, what are the meanings of these two in detail? In detail. So in the first part, we have seen that our response is comprising two parts, transient part and the steady state part. Okay. So always the first part of our response is the transient response, and the remaining half is a steady state response. So still we will try to understand what is this transient response. Okay. So its notation is CT of T. This should be clear first, because this term is used very often in our entire module, CT of T. So even the block diagrams, we have seen that the response is written as C of T, or in the transformed version as C of S. Okay. So C of T means the response is time response. It is evaluated with respect to time. So therefore, this suffix T indicates it is a transient response. Okay. So therefore, the transient response of the feedback system is represented as CT of T. Okay. So therefore, what is its formal definition? It is defined as the output variations, okay, before reaching the steady state value. Okay, so transient response is nothing but that part of the response. Okay, so before reaching the steady state. Okay, so what is the nature of this transient response? So the transient response are not permanent response. Okay, so these responses are going to diminish gradually, or this response dies out gradually as the response approaches desired value. So that is temporarily the transients appear, okay. So but gradually their amplitude diminishes. So as the time t tends towards higher value, or as our response approaches the desired value, and it also gives information about rate of rise of output. That is what is the feature of transient response. Okay. So the transient response, it shows how fast the system, how fast the output or the response of the system increases. Okay. In other words, it also shows sensitivity of the system to the applied input also. Okay. So one more point is the nature of the output. Okay. So during transient period is either exponential or oscillatory. Okay. So how this transient response looks. Okay. What is its nature? The answer is, the transient nature is nothing but either it is exponential or oscillatory during the transient period. Okay. So these are some of the features of transient response. First of all, its notation is CT of T. It is measured with respect to time. Next one is, transient response is nothing but it represents variations in the output of a system before reaching one steady state output. And other one is, it is not a permanent response. This is a kind of response which gradually reduces, diminishes, or dies out. Okay, as our response approaches the desired value. Okay, it temporarily appears. That's all. Okay, the permanent response is a steady state response. Okay, but before going to the steady state, so whatever the initial transients are there, so that part of the output is called transient behavior or the transient response. The other one is, this transient response is either exponential nature or it is oscillatory in nature. Okay, that is about a transient response. Okay. Then steady state, coming to the steady state response. So this is another half of the overall or the entire response of the system. So what is this notation? CSS. Okay, you have to write actually CSS of T. The double S here indicates it is steady state. So inside the bracket you should mention T. Okay, so therefore it is that part of the time response which remains constant after the transient response dies out. That is, it is that part of our entire response which remains after the transient response diminishes or reduces or completely vanishes. Okay, so this is the one which is going to be retained. Okay, so transient response appears only for a short period of time. Okay, so later on our response is going to be settled. Okay, so that is gradually it becomes a steady state. So what is the other significance? Steady state value of the output is a final value achieved by response of the system. Okay, so this is what should be measured, as it is the final output which is achieved by the particular system. And also, this steady state, it gives information about steady state error also. Okay, so always in the control systems, okay, so the output may not reach the designed value. So therefore, how much is the error that is measured using the steady state response of the system only? Okay, so that is what one of the significance of the steady state responses. Then what any other features? It gives information about the steady state error. Okay, so therefore the total response of that system is nothing but the sum of transient response CT of t and steady state response CSS of t. So it can be stated that the total response of the system is a sum of transient response and steady state response. Okay, so this page displays important highlights about transient and the steady state. So first of all, transient response is the very basic one, and it's a very temporary one. Okay, so it gradually diminishes and gradually reduces once our response starts approaching the steady state value. Okay, so whereas steady state response is that part of the response which remains constant once the transient response dies out. Okay, so and also the steady state response is the last output, or it is a final output, and it helps us to calculate what is the steady state error for that particular excitation. Okay, so these are the features, and therefore in order to evaluate the entire response of the system, you have to take the sum of both transient response and the steady state response. Okay, so moving on to the next page, so where through some pictures these two responses are shown. Okay, so here it is written that our C of t, that is overall response of the system, is equal to sum of transient response and steady state response. Okay, so why one of the reason CSS is only written is maybe once it is steady, you know, irrespective of time t, okay, output will not change. Okay, in that respect it can be written as CSS, or otherwise the correct method would be CSS of t to write. So therefore here these two diagrams, figure 1 and 2, they show the nature of transient and steady state response. Okay, so here you can see that the x axis is a t and y axis is a plot of C of t. Okay, now just zoom this response part. Okay, so this is one picture where our transient response is exponential in nature. So in the last page we have seen that the responses can be the transient response can be either exponential or oscillatory. Okay, but steady state is always the one, it's a constant output. Okay, so only the transient has either exponential in nature or it is oscillatory in nature. So whenever the transient response is exponential in nature, so the response is like this. Okay, so this part of the graph shows the transient period it is. Okay, so once transient part is over, then the steady state part starts. So from this point onwards our output remains constant. So therefore this entire part where there is an exponential rise in the output is represented as CT of t, and once exponential starts growing further and output becomes constant, from that point onwards we start measuring the steady state output. Okay, now here this is for a applied step input. What is the output that is plotted? Okay, so there are step input or a ramp input for standard inputs are there. So for those standard inputs, what is the response is plotted. Okay, so here in this example a step input is considered to plot the response. So this horizontal line, this line shows it is a step input. So then this is the exponential part of our transient. Okay, so once this is over, then steady state will start. Now here you can see that this gap represents error in the steady state response. Okay, so of course, whatever, how, what is the percentage of error and all, it can be measured once our transients are over and the response begins to remain constant. Okay, so that's why all steady state errors are measured in the steady state part of the output. Okay, so this is one diagram. Now this picture shows whenever our transients are oscillatory in nature. Okay, so here you can see that for the same applied step input, so the transients are oscillatory in nature. Okay, so as soon as the system starts generating the output is so much oscillatory in nature, but gradually you can see that amplitude of the oscillation reduces and comes to a halt, and afterwards gradually output remains constant. Okay, so therefore, so as long as oscillations are present in the response, that entire part is considered as transient period only. And once response becomes standstill or constant, so that point onwards, the response is known as steady state. Okay. Now, even here also, the response may not be 100% correct. It may be associated with some percentage of error. So all those errors will be calculated in the steady state part only. Okay, so now these two pictures shows exponential type of transients and oscillatory type of transient response. Okay, so this is three. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this part was clear. The basic definition.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So the next, have some standard test signals. Okay, so what are those signals? Test signals. So now, in order to test the behavior, okay, without applying the actual inputs, the system behavior is studied by applying some test signals. Okay, so it is. The system behavior is analyzed for these standard test signals. It is given here that in a control system, the output behavior with respect to time, okay, should be within specified limits to have the satisfactory results. Okay, that is, the response is expected to stay within the specified limits to have a good results. So the complete time response, okay, governs the accuracy and the system stability. Now this is verified, whether our response is staying within the specified limits or not, whether the system is able to generate satisfactory results or not. So everything is tested by applying standard test signals. Okay, so what are those test signals? So here we have the three test signals. Among them, first one is a step signal, impulse is the second one, third one is a ramp, other one is a parabolic signals. So they define some particular patterns, and whenever you are applying the actual signal, it may be a combination of all these also. Okay, so that's why the system is analyzed for individual test signals, and later on whenever actual input is applied, okay, it can be a combination of all this. Okay, it is just like if I know what is the system behavior for 1 unit, I can calculate what is the system behavior for 10 units. Okay, so I need not apply 10 units and check what will be the response. So instead of that, I can apply only 1 unit, and for that I can study how the system behaves. It is just like impulse response in your signals and systems. Okay, so for one impulse, what is the output? Similarly, for a combination of inputs, you will later measure what is the system, how the system is going to respond for such an input. Okay, so therefore we will see one by one what is the nature of these signals. So a step signal, what is this? It represents a sudden change. And similarly, an impulse, it represents a sudden shock. A ramp represents constant velocity, okay? And a parabolic represents constant acceleration. So now these are actually defining how the rate of change or the pattern in which the system input is changing. And now we are evaluating for all these changes, so how the system is going to respond for this. For example, if your system is applied with a sudden change, okay, and that sudden change is modeled by step signal, Okay. So then what is the system response for such a input? Then if the input, if the system is applied with an input which behaves like a sudden shock. Okay. So that sudden shock, it is modeled by an impulse. We know impulse signal nature. Okay. So it appears at only one point, and at remaining all time, its value or its amplitude is zero. So when such an input is applied to control system, so what is its behavior? Okay, that is studied by applying an impulse input. Now, whenever your input behaves like a constant velocity, that is, its rate is increasing at a certain, or its amplitude is increasing at certain rate, then how the system may behavior? Okay, so in order to study that, such a input is modeled by ramp signal. Okay, so therefore we will look at these signals, test signals individually, and it is like this. Step signal, first one. So it is like, okay, so step input is nothing but signal whose value changes from one level, usually from zero, to another level in zero time. In zero time, so within no time, okay, the signal level is changed. So such a nature is known as a step input. Okay, its mathematical representation is R of t. So here we are using R of t to represent our input and C of t to represent our outputs. So therefore R of t is equal to A into U of t, where A represents the amplitude. Okay, if A is equal to 1, R of t is simply, that is equal to U. Okay, and further, how a step input is defined? U of t is equal to 1, U of t value is equal to 1 for t greater than or equal to 0, and its value is 0 for t less than 0. So this is a mathematical representation for step input. So after applying Laplace transform, if I evaluate R of s, so R of s will be equal to A by s. If A is equal to 1, R of s will be equal to 1 by s. Okay. So later you prepare one small table, R of t, R of s for step, ramp, and the impulse input. Okay. So as of now, we will see. So for a given R of t with amplitude A, you can imagine A as 1. Simply it is 1. Okay. Then R of t will be defined like this. So therefore, it is, its value is 1 for t greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Then its value will be 0 for t less than 0. That is, below reference, its value will be 0. That's all. Then ramp input. So the ramp nature is like this. It's a signal which starts at a value 0 and it increases linearly with time. It increases linearly with time. Okay. So therefore, mathematically, it is modeled as R of t equal to A into t. If A is equal to 1, R of t is equal to t. That's all. Okay. It's a linear behavior. Okay. So therefore, after applying Laplace transformation, R of s is equal to A by s square. And if your A is equal to 1, if your slope is 1, A, here A represents the slope, that's all. Okay, if A is equal to 1, then R of s is equal to simply 1 by s square. Then parabolic input. Parabolic input. So here I have not shown the diagram. Okay, maybe in the next pages you can see. So a parabolic input, its behavior is like this. R of t is t square by 2. It is not a ramp. Okay, so its behavior is something different from the ramp. Okay, and it is t square by 2 for t greater than 0. It is for t greater than 0. And its Laplace transform, it gives A by s cube, or if A is equal to 1, it is simply 1 by s cube. Similarly, an impulse is okay, and a unit impulse is a one which is defined as a signal which has a zero value anywhere except at time t equal to 0. So where its magnitude will be exactly 1. So even in S&S signals and system also, you might have used this impulse signal many times. So an impulse behaves like a sudden shock. That is, it is just a single peak which appears at time t equal to 0 or n equal to 0 in case of discrete, and its value is 0 elsewhere. Okay, so that is the impulse signal. Maybe I have displayed it in the next page. Here it is there, impulse. Okay, so and its impulse is defined as R of t is equal to A. A here represents the amplitude for time t equal to 0 only. and its value is 0 for t not equal to 0. So t may be plus or minus. Okay. So elsewhere its value will be 0 and its amplitude is present, or the signal is present only at time t equal to 0. Okay. So here in this page I have derived the Laplace transform of previous said standard inputs, maybe for ramp and the impulse. Later you can refer to them. Okay, the derivations are there. Later you refer those derivations. Okay, so now my intention was to give you the brief idea regarding the test signals, because in the next topics we are applying the standard inputs to the control systems for first order and second order, and we are verifying their behavior for the standard test signal, that is step input only. Okay, so in the next page maybe I have given some more information on this. That's what. Okay, so for parabolic also, so how are you going to get this A by SQ? This part I have derived. Okay, so you can practice it. Then what's the time? 6:41. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Okay,
so did you listen? Did you listen clearly the last part?
Yes.
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So, oh, ma'am, it's not audible.
Hello. So that was the introduction about time response
analysis. Yes, ma'am.
That was the introduction about time response analysis and what are the test signals we have. That's all. So next what we have is time response for first order system and time response for the second order system. And now here you have to apply a standard test signal. Okay, then how a first order system gives a response for such a signal. Okay. So that is derived by writing an equivalent block diagram, and further we are going to derive its C of t also. C of t means response of the system in time domain, and in the C of t we are going to check by substituting various t values. So how the response is going to change with t. Okay, and that is done for both first order system as well as for the second order system. So to begin with, here I have the time response of first order system. So you can see here a first order system within the very basic block diagram form. You have an input R of S. There is a forward path with a gain 1 by TS, and there is a feedback with a unity feedback, and then the response here, it is evaluated C of S, and whatever the error that is generated, it is E of S. Then before going into this detailed part of evaluating C of T, so what is this order here? Okay, so order of the system is the highest power of S. Order of the system is the highest power of S in the denominator of a closed loop transfer function. Okay, so you are deriving a closed loop transfer function. In that transfer function, the highest power of S is going to tell you about order of the system. Okay, so this has got only one root here. Okay, for example, here you can see that in this particular block diagram version, this is a closed loop transfer function. So why this 1 by TS plus 1 is a closed loop transfer function? Because this is 1 by TS is the forward path gain for such a first order system. Okay, so with this forward path gain with a unity feedback, now you can imagine this as a G, this as H. H is equal to 1 here. Okay, with H is equal to 1, for such a single loop feedback system, its transfer function is C of S by R of S equal to C of S by R of S is equal to G of S divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S. Okay, as H of S is 1, you are going to get only 1 divided by T of S plus 1 as a transfer function. Later you derive this. This is your G, H is 1. So therefore, transfer function is equal to G divided by 1 plus G into H. Why it is 1 plus? Because negative feedback is shown here. That's why transfer function is G divided by 1 plus G into H. You take H is equal to 1. So therefore, it is 1 by TS whole divided by 1 plus 1 by TS. So that is the overall transfer function looks like this. 1 by TS plus 1. Okay. So this is the very ideal block diagram of a first order system. Okay, so a first order system is one whose transfer function it looks like this. One by, that is the denominator part, which is called as the characteristic equation of the system. Okay, so TS plus 1 equal to 0, or TS is equal to minus 1, or S is equal to minus 1 by T. So it's a single pole system. Okay, it's a single pole system. That's why it is the first order system. For a second order system, our equation has highest power 2. You have like a quadratic equation. It is AX square plus BX plus C equal to 0. Okay, so it will be TS square plus BS plus 1 equal to 0. So when I take up the second order, that equation I'll give. So as of now, the first order system with the transfer function looking like this, that is 1 by TS plus 1. Now for this system, what is the C of T that we are going to evaluate? So this the derivation is little bit lengthy itself. This is the previous page. This is what is. So you have to write down, okay, anyway, I have written here anyway, C of S by R of S, okay? For such a simple single loop block diagram, which is known as first order system, its transfer function looks like this, 1 by TS plus 1, as already stated, 1 by TS plus 1. Now here, C of S by R of S is equal to 1 by TS plus 1. So it is still in the transfer function form. So C of S is nothing but it is output. R of S is the input. Okay. So now in this, we are evaluating what response. Okay. So we are interested in looking at only the response of the first order system. That is, which is a response part here. C of S is a response part. Whereas R of S is the input. Okay. So for the applied input R of S, what is the response? And in time domain, what is the C of T? What is the expression for C of T for such a first order system that we need to derive. So therefore now I am gradually changing it so that on the LHS I have only C of S. Now I am shifting this R of S on the other side. So therefore anyway, we will start with this C of S by R of S equal to 1 divided by TS plus 1. So therefore now I need only C of S on LHS. So therefore I am shifting the R of S on the other side. Now here you can see. So for a step input, you are evaluating the response of the first order system. Now, in order to evaluate the response, some inputs has to be applied. Okay. So, what is that input? Input is a unit step signal. Okay. So, when a unit step input is applied, how the system behaves? What is the response of that system that is evaluated? So, therefore, the step input is defined as R of T equal to 1. Okay. When R of T is equal to 1, its R of S is equal to 1 by S. So, therefore, take this equation and substitute what is the R of S. So R of S is 1 by S, that is equal to 1 by TS. And therefore, I need only C of S on the LHS. So when C of S is retained on LHS, this 1 by S will be shifted here. So therefore, it becomes 1 by S divided by TS plus 1, or it is equal to 1 by S into 1 by TS plus 1. 1 by TS plus 1. So therefore, C of S is equal to 1 by S into TS plus 1. Now, using partial fractions, it is expanded that this is equal to again A by S plus B divided by TS plus 1. And you know how to find out the constants A and B. Okay, so individually, you have to find out. You are applying the limits. So when you apply limit S tends to 0, we are going to get the A value. When you apply limit S tends to minus 1 by T, we are going to get the B value. So it is done by using expansion through partial fractions. So A value is 1, B value is minus T. Once you get these two values, now again go back to this equation, substitute what are A and B. So therefore my C of S, now it looks like this. C of S is equal to 1 by S. Why it is only 1 by S? Because C of S is A by S plus B. A value is 1. A value is 1. So therefore it is 1 by S plus B is minus T. So therefore here minus T divided by TS plus 1. Or this TS plus 1 can be written as 1 divided by S plus 1 by T also. Because I have to still apply inverse Laplace transform to go back into time domain mode. Therefore, to apply ILT, I have to get a form like this. 1 divided by S plus A. So that's why it is simplified as 1 divided by S plus 1 by T. Now, once you rewrite this as 1 by S plus 1 by T. So now I am changing C of S into C of T by taking the inverse Laplace transform. So therefore, C of T equal to, for 1 by S, its ILT is 1. Minus minus as it is. For this function, this already we have changed it as this. And we know that Laplace transform of e to the power of minus at is 1 by s plus a. So therefore, inverse Laplace transform of 1 by s plus a should be e to the power of minus at. So therefore, ILT of this part is nothing but e power minus small t by capital T. Therefore, this equation 2 represents the time response for first order system. C of t equal to 1 minus e to the power of minus t by capital T. Now in this response, there are two parts. This one is identified as a steady state response, and e to the power of minus t by t is the transient response. Okay, we know the transient response is exponential in nature or oscillatory in nature. Okay, whereas steady state part is a fixed one. Okay, it's a constant one. So therefore, the C of t equal to 1 minus e power minus t by t shows that, okay. So the first order response, it comprises of both steady state as well as the transient part. Now, if this part becomes 0 here, then C of t is exactly equal to 1. But as long as this part exists, output to C of t is always less than 1. So now how C of t varies with various values of t, that we will see through a graph.